بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. أما بعد, this is the 83rd lesson going through the book Umdat Ahkaam من كلام خير الأنام صلى الله عليه وسلم authored by عبد الغني المقدسي رحمه الله تعالى within كتاب الأطعمة أو يعني بعد باب الصيد. الصيد refers to hunting, and hunting in its original state it's permissible. الأصل في الصيد التحليل أنها مباح, that it's permissible except for the person who's in the state of إحرام and he is trying to hunt a land animal, فهذا لا يجوز. قال الله تعالى وحرم عليكم صيد البر ما دمتم حرما. And so بمفهوم المخالفة, that if you are not in a state of إحرام فيجوز صيد البر. As for the first حديث عن أبي ثعلبة الخشني قال أتيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقلت يا رسول الله إنا بأرض قوم أهل كتاب أفنأكل في آنيتهم وفي أرض أصيد بقوسي وبكلبي الذي ليس بمعلم وبكلبي المعلم فما يصلح لي. So here Abu Thalaba asked a multitude of questions to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم in one question. So he asked a number of questions in one question. And so the first question that he asked was, we are in a land of people who are the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians. Can we eat from their utensils? So can I get a plate from a kafir and eat from that plate? Or can I use a spoon that the kafir made, for example? Likewise, I'm in a land where I hunt with my bow and arrow. وَبِكَلْبِي الَّذِي لَيْسَ بِمُعَلَّمٍ. And likewise, I hunt with a dog that I haven't taught. What does مُعَلَّم mean? مُعَلَّم means someone that meets, or a dog that meets four conditions. The first condition is that يَقِفُ حِينَ تَقُولُ لَهُ قِفْ. When you tell that dog to stop, he stops. And when you tell that dog to go, he goes. And so he's a dog that you have trained, a trained dog. A dog that you have trained. And when you tell a dog to go and hunt an animal, he goes and hunts the animal, وَلَا يَأْكُلُ مِنْهَا, and he doesn't eat from that animal. And this occurs from him repetitively. So when you meet these, when you see these four conditions in a dog, where when you tell him to sit, he sits, when you tell him to stand, he stands, when you tell him to do this, he does that, when you tell him to not do that, he doesn't do it, and when you tell him to hunt an animal, he hunts an animal and he doesn't eat from it, rather when he kills it, it stops, or he hunts it for you and he just stops and he waits for you. طيب, وَلَا يَأْكُلُ مِنْهَا شَيْئًا. And it occurs repetitively, and it's a repeated action from him. It doesn't just occur one time and then he doesn't do it any other time. Rather, it's a repetitive action from this dog. فَهَذَا الْكَلْبُ يُسَمَّى كَلْبُ مُعَلَّمُ. This dog is treated as a trained dog. And the dog that is not trained is one that doesn't meet these four conditions. So a dog that doesn't meet any one of these four conditions is considered كَلْبُ لَيْسَ بِمُعَلَّمُ. And so Abu Tha'laba radiallahu anhu, he is hunting with his bow and arrow. And we know the hukm concerning that, we mentioned it. Al-aslu fiha al-hil. As for al-kalb alladhi laysa bi-mu'allam, that's the second point that the companion made. And the third point is wa bi-kalbi al-mu'allam. So I have a trained dog, I have a non-trained dog, and I have my bow and arrow. Fama yasluhu li. And so now he's asking from the Messenger of Allah to tell him which is best for him. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أما ما ذكرت. And then here the Rawi speaks, يعني من آنية أهل الكتاب. Then the Messenger of Allah continues speaking, فإن وجدتم غيرها فلا تأكلوا فيها. So here the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says that if you find utensils other than the utensils of the kuffar, then don't eat from the utensils of the kuffar. وهذا للاستحباب. هذا الأمر هنا يفيد الاستحباب. It shows recommendation, not obligation. طيب. And so it's permissible for a person to eat from the utensils of the disbelievers. You are allowed to do that. There is no problem in it. But wash it, as we see later on in the hadith. وَإِن لَمْ تَجِدُوا فَغْسِلُوهَا وَكُلُوا فِيهَا. And so here, the illah, the reason why the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is advising us to stay away from the utensils of the disbelievers, is because if you get it, there may be potential of najis, something which is filthy or impure in that utensil. And so if you wash that utensil, then zala, that problem goes away. And so if that problem has gone away, then you can consume it and you can eat from it. طيب. And so that also when it comes to the utensils, whether it belongs to a disbeliever or a believer, whether it belongs to a mushrik or غير mushrik, a muwahid, then you are allowed to eat from it. You are allowed to consume, you are allowed to use it as a plate for your food. طيب. There is no problem with that. You are allowed to store in it your food and so on. There is no problem with it. But if it's come from a disbeliever, you should wash it. You should wash it. And of course, يعني, in today's society, people are super hygienic, super clean. And so whether it comes from a believer or a disbeliever, they're still washing it. And so, somebody goes to IKEA or goes to TK Maxx or whatever it is and buys some utensils, and these are utensils of course from disbelievers. When he comes home, what does he do? He washes it. هذا هو الأصل. And so as soon as you washed it, زالة, the problem has gone away, and so then you can consume from it. There is no problem in that. The only types of utensils that are haram for us to use and eat from is, as we mentioned in the early sections of this book, in Bab al-Ani, I believe, we mentioned إِلَّا كَالْإِلَّا آنِيَةَ الذَّهَبْ وَالْفِضَّةِ. We are not allowed to eat from the آنية, the utensils that are made from pure gold and pure silver. طيب. And we mentioned this in Kitab al-Tahara. That is the answer to the first question that the Prophet ﷺ received from this great companion, Abu Tha'labah radiyallahu an. As for the answer to the second and third question, which is the whole purpose of why this hadith is brought under this chapter title, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, وَمَا صِدْتَ بِقَوْسِكَ فَذَكَرْتَ اسْمَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ فَكُلْ. That which you have hunted with your bow and arrow, and you mention Allah's name upon it, then eat from it. And of course, this is the asl. And of course, ذِكْرُ اسْمَ اللَّهِ, the mentioning of the name of Allah عز وجل, هذا لِلِاسْتِحْبَابِ عِنْدَ الشَّافِعِيَّةِ. This is a recommended act according to the Shafi'iyya. And so if a person was to hunt with his bow and arrow an animal, and of course the animal has to be an animal which is halal for us to eat, of course, for example, a lizard or a gazelle or a zebra and so on. These animals that are generally hunted, a deer and so on. These animals are halal for us to eat. And so if a person was to, you know, hit his or use his bow and arrow and hunt that animal down, طيب, or مثلا he uses his arrow or his bow or his spear or whatever it may be that pierces through the animal and that kills the animal, if he says it with the name of Allah Azza wa Jal, فَهَذَا لِلِاسْتِحْبَابِ عِنْدَ الشَّافِعِيَّةِ. This is recommended for him to add the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to mention the name of Allah. As for it being obligatory, فَهَذَا عِنْدَ الْحَنَفِيَّةِ وَالْحَنَابِلَةِ وَالْمَالِكِيَّةِ. Right? And as for the three madahib, they say if a person leaves off the mentioning of the name of Allah عَمْدًا, فَلَا يَجُزْ أَكْلُ ذَلِكَ الصَّيْدِ. They say that if the person leaves off the name of Allah on purpose whilst shooting down or hunting down an animal with his bow and arrow, then this is not allowed. This food is not allowed for you to eat. As for if one leaves it off out of forgetfulness, then he's allowed to eat from it. As for the Shafi'iyyah, either way, it's just recommended and not wajib. وَمَا صِدْتَ بِكَلْبِكَ الْمُعَلِّمِ فَذَكَرْتَ اسْمَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ فَكُلْ. And likewise, we attach the same hukum to the كَلْبَ الْمُعَلِّمِ. So if you hunt with a trained dog, and you mention the conditions for the trained dog, then, and you mention the name of Allah, then you are allowed to eat from that animal that was hunted. As for, وَمَا صِدْتَ بِكَلْبِهَ غَيْرِ الْمُعَلَّمِ فَأَدْرَكْتَ ذَكَاتَهُ فَكُلْ. And as for that which you use a non-trained dog to hunt, so a non-trained dog hunts a animal, and you reach that animal before it dies, and you slaughter the animal with ذَكَاتٍ شَرْعِيَّةٍ, then you can eat from it. But if you reach the animal and it's already died, then you can't eat from it. فَصَيْدُ الْكَلْبِ غَيْرَ الْمُعَلَّمِ لَا يَجُزُ أَكْلُهُ إِذَا مَاتَ قَبْلَ أَن تَصِلَ إِلَيْهِ. If the animal whom you sent a trained dog to hunt, and he hunts it down and he kills it, then you can't eat from it, if it's a non-trained dog. If it's a trained dog, then you can eat from it, even if he kills it. طيب. Because the trained dog, we mentioned the conditions for it, يَقِفُ حَيْثُ قُلْتُ وَيَذْهَبُ حَيْثُ قُلْتُ لَهُ أَن يَذْهَبْ وَلَا يَكُلُ مِنَ الصَّيْدِ وَيَتَكَرَّرُ ذَلِكَ مِنْهُ. These four conditions. And so the kalb ghayr al-mu'allam, he doesn't meet any one of these four conditions, or he doesn't meet a condition from these four conditions. And so if he kills the animal that he thought that non-trained dog to hunt, that animal, if you reach it and it's already dead, la ta'kul min. But if he hasn't died yet and he's still alive, then slaughter it the way that you slaughter a normal animal, and you can then consume from it. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. As for the next hadith, عن همام بن الحارث عن عدي بن حاتم الطائي رضي الله عنه قال قلت يا رسول الله إني أرسل الكلاب المعلمة فيمسكن علي وأذكر اسم الله علي فقال إذا أرسلت كلبك المعلم وذكرت اسم الله فكل ما أمسك عليك. So this part of the hadith we mentioned it previously, that the كلب المعلم, if you set it out to hunt an animal and it hunts the animal and you mention the name of Allah upon it, then you can eat from it, لا حرج. وإن قتلنا. And so Adi asks, even if it kills, قَالَ وَإِنْ قَتَلْنَا. Even if the كَلْبُ الْمُعَلَّمِ killed that animal that you set it out to hunt, if it kills, and you mentioned this previously, then you can still consume from it. Why? Because the كلب المعلم will not eat from it. لن يأكل منها. The conditions for كلب المعلم is أنه لا يأكل من الصيد حتى وإن قتلها. That is the condition that has to be found in the كلب المعلم. If that condition is not found, then the كلب is not معلم, is غير معلم. The companion continues to ask another question, or the messenger of Allah continues to answer, وإن قتلنا ما لم يشركها كلب ليس منها. And so there is a condition set upon the killing. Let's say we have two dogs, a trained dog and an untrained dog, and I set them both to kill or hunt an animal, and they both hunt the animal and the animal dies. Can I eat from it? The answer is no. Why? Because the asl when it comes to al-luhum is a tahrim. والأصل في الأضلاع واللحوم والنفس والأموال للمعصوم تحريمها حتى يجيء الحل ففهم هداك الله ما يمل كما قال السعدي رحمه الله. And we spoke about this in our commentary on al-qawaid al-fiqhiyya, in that the asl when it comes to al-luhum, meat, is that it is haram. You're not allowed to eat it until you have a reason for you to eat it, until there is a permissibility, and until the permissibility is clear. And so in this case, I have a reason that is halal and I have a reason that is haram. So the non-trained dog, we know that if it hunts an animal and it kills that animal, لا يجوز أكلها. And we know that if the كلب المعلم hunts an animal and it kills it, يجوز أكلها. If they both now come to kill one animal, how do you know the person or the dog that killed it? لا تعلم. You have no idea which dog was the one who killed that animal. And so because of these two matters that have come together, we always give precedence to the haram over the halal. يقدم الحرام يقدم ما سببه التحريم على ما سببه الحل. We have two reasons here. We have two points here. You have one point that is halal and one point that is haram, and it's come together. Which do we give precedence to? We give precedence to that which is haram. And we spoke about this qa'idah earlier on in our series, and we spoke about this in qa'idah fiqhiyya as well in detail. And so the Messenger of Allah is clarifying this qa'idah in this hadith, which is that وَإِن قَتَلْنَا مَا لَمْ يَشْرَكْهَا كَلْبٌ لَيْسَ مِنْهَا. So if the dog is, the trained dog has been shared with a non-trained dog in the killing of an animal, in the hunting down of an animal, and that animal, when you see it, it's dead, and you don't know which was the cause of death, or who was the cause of death, was it your كلب المعلم or كلب غير المعلم, then you stay away from that hunted animal. فَقُلْتُ لَهُ, so Adi continues to say, فإني أرمي بالمعراض الصيد فأصيب فقال إذا رميت بالمعراض فخزق فكله وإن أصابه بعرض فلا تأكل. So now another point that Adi ibn Hatim makes is that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, oh Messenger of Allah, I throw a spear بالمعراض. المعراض is the type of spear. الصيد, and I hit the صيد, and I hit the hunted animal. And so the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, إذا رميت بالمعراض فخزق فكل. If you throw a spear at a hunted animal, and that spear pierces through the animal, i.e. the metal part of the spear, the iron sharp part of the spear pierces through the animal, then you can eat from it. However, if the wooden part of the spear, so the spear consists of a metal part, a sharp part, which is the part which usually pierces through, and you have a part which is يعني, in which you hold, the hot part which you hold, which is the blunt, or which you could say the wooden part. And so if the wooden part hits the hunted animal, فلا تأكل منها. And so this is a reference or a hint at animals that are hit. So when you hit an animal, ضربتها, if you hit an animal, so you're hunting an animal and you hit it instead of piercing through it, طيب, then this hunted animal which you have hit and you've killed it via way of hitting, لا يجوز أكلها, you can't eat from it. طيب, this is ميتة. So if you hit an animal to death, then you can't eat from that animal. Likewise, in this hadith, it shows us that if we hit or if we throw a spear and the spear pierces through the metal part, through the part which is supposed to hit the animal, then you can eat from it. But if it's hidden via any other method outside of the piercing, لا يجوز أكلها, you can't eat from it. As the Messenger of Allah, he said, فلا تأكله. As for the hadith of al-Sha'bi and Adi, so al-Sha'bi from Imam al-Tabi'een, من أئمة التابعين, I should say. So we see that the previous hadith was عن Humam ibn al-Harith, عن عدي, and this is عن حديث الشعبي عن عدي نحوه, and it was like the same hadith as Humam report from عدي بن حاتم. And in it as well was an extended point, was the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, إلا أن يأكل الكلب فإن أكل فلا تأكل فإن يخاف أن يكون إنما أمسك على نفسه وإن خالطها كلاب من غيرها فلا تأكل. And so this strengthens what we mentioned previously, that if your dog eats from the hunted animal that he's been set to hunt, then it's not كالمعلم, And so the كلب المعلم لا يجوز كلب غير المعلم لا يجوز أكل صيده إذا قتله. Likewise, if a mixture of dogs come together to hunt an animal, and from them is your dog that you have trained, then you can't eat from it because you don't know which was the source or which one of the dogs killed that hunted animal. So you can't eat from that hunted animal either. Another narration: فإنما سميت على كلبك ولم تسمي على غيره. Because you sent a tasmiya upon your trained dog, you said. When you sent your trained dog, you said Bismillah upon the trained dog, not upon the other dogs who came and joined him in that hunting process. وفيه أيضا إذا أرسلت كلبك المكلب فاذكر اسم الله فإن أمسك عليك فأدركته حيا فاذبحه وإن أدركته قد قتل ولم يأكل منه فكله. Even if you were to send, and so this hadith mentions another point, which is that if you send your trained dog and you mention the name of Allah, then if your dog catches that hunted animal, whether it be a rabbit or a deer, whatever it may be, and you find that rabbit to be alive still, then slaughter it. And if you find it that the dog has killed that animal and he hasn't eaten from it, then it's كلب معلم فكل منه. فإن أخذ الكلب ذكاته. Because the taking of the dog, or the dog taking the life of that animal, is the zakat. And because this dog is كلب معلم فيجوز أكله ما قتله صيدا. وفيه أيضا إذا رميت بسهمك فاذكر اسم الله. Likewise, if you were to throw a spear or an arrow at your hunted animal, then mention the name of Allah. So if you want to hunt a deer or a zebra or a rabbit and you want to throw your spear at it, mention the name of Allah. We mentioned that in the شافعية للاستحباب. وفيه أيضا فإن غاب عنك يوما أو يومين وفي رواية اليومين والثلاثة فلن تجد إلا أثر سهمك فكل إن شئت فإن وجدته غريقا في الماء فلا تأكل فإنك لا تدري الماء قتله أو سهمك. And so this hadith, or this part of the hadith, mentions to us and clarifies to us the principle that I highlighted previously, which that if you find two points in a certain issue, a point which makes it halal and a point which makes it haram, you give precedence to the point that makes it haram over the point that makes it halal. طيب. And so here, when you find let's say you threw an arrow at a hunted animal, and that hunted animal fell into the sea. Mathalan, you threw a spear at a bird, and you hit that bird, but the bird fell into the sea. You don't know what killed it. Was it the drowning or was it the actual spear? طيب. And so you can't eat from that bird. However, let's say you killed an animal and you couldn't find the animal for 2 or 3 days. Then you find it 2 or 3 days later, and the only source of death that you can find upon that animal is your spear. Then you can eat from that animal if you so wish. As for the next hadith, عن سالم عن عبد الله ابن عمر عن أبيه. And so this is a beautiful chain. سالم بن عبد الله عن أبيه عن جده. سالم من كبار الأئمة من أئمة التابعين ومن أثبت الناس بل أثبت الناس عن عمر. The most authoritative narrator from ابن عمر رضي الله عنه, from his father. And ابن عمر is narrated from his father. And so we have سالم عن عبد الله عن عمر. And سالم is the son of Abdullah and he's the son of عمر. And that is a beautiful, beautiful chain. He said, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول من اقتنى كلبا إلا كلب صيد أو ماشية فإنه ينقص من أجله كل يوم قيراطان. قال سالم وكان أبو هريرة يقول أو كلب حرث وكان صاحب حرث. And so the اصل is that when it comes to dogs, we're not allowed to buy them. So people who have pet dogs and all of that nonsense, they're not allowed to do that. هذا لا يجوز, لا يجوز. The only types of dogs that are permitted for a person to buy and to consume, i.e. to have, is كلب صيد, a dog that is going to be used for hunting. Or كلب ماشية. كلب ماشية can refer to two types. The shepherd, the dog that helps you in your herding of sheep, and the dog that is considered a guide dog. So ماشية, i.e. ماشية للغنم وماشية للإنسان الكفيف. So the two types of dogs that are permitted in this scenario that falls under الماشية is the sheep dog and the dog that is considered a guide dog. That is also permissible. And عند أبي هريرة, an extended or an extra type of dog, which is كلب حارثين, the guard dog. And so these three types of dogs that guard your مزرعة, your مثلا your farm, or dogs that guard your home and so on, these are permitted for you to have, to buy. And you're also permitted to buy the dog of hunting, the dog for the purpose of hunting, and also a dog for the purpose of herding your sheep, and also the dog that can be used as a guide dog for the blind people and who need it. And of course, that's of course a modern case. طيب. And so the ulama rahimahumullah permitted it. Anyone who has any dog other than those types of dogs, for example, the pet dog that people have today, then know that you are losing from your reward every day qiratan. And qirat is mithlu jabadi Uhud, is like the mountain of Uhud in terms of reward. And so you're losing all of that reward just for having a dog in your home. That is not from the dogs that are exceptions to the principle. So one must avoid buying dogs, engaging in dog businesses and so on. And as for the final hadith in this subchapter, وعن رافع بن خديجة رضي الله عنه قال كنا مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بذي الحليفة من تهامة. And so the context here is that the Messenger of Allah was with his companions, and they had just come back from a expedition. And the people became hungry. فأصاب الناس وجوعٌ فأصابوا إبلاً وغنماً. And so the people became hungry, and they were suffering from severe starvation. And so they had some camels and some sheep that they had won as war booty. And so the people were in the state of starvation, and they had with them ibil, camels and ghanam, sheep that they had gained from the war or the expedition that had taken place as war booty. And the Messenger of Allah كان في أخريات القوم, he was at the back of the army, and so he hadn't yet reached the Dhul Hulayfa, which is of course the miqat for Ahl Medina, right? And it's just outside of Medina. فعجلوا وذبحوا ونصبوا القدور. And so these people who were in this state of starvation, they became hasty and they slaughtered these ibil and these ghanam, and they set up the cooking stoves and they started cooking the meat that they had slaughtered from these animals. طيب. And so this is something which is not allowed. Why? Because this is the ghanima, this is the war booty, and this war booty has to be divided among the combatants. And this process of dividing between the combatants, this ghanima, hadn't yet taken place. And these people, they were hasty. And so when the Messenger of Allah saw this and he reached this place, Dhul Hulayfa, أَمَرَ بِالْقُدُورِ فَأُكْفِيَتْ, he commanded that these stoves be shut off, and that anywhere where you found the meat or the maraq from that meat, to pour it out. طيب. And then the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he divided up the ghanima between the combatants, and he equated 10 ghanam to one sheep, to one camel. He equated 10 sheep to one camel. فَنَدَّ مِنْهَا بَعِيرٌ, however, one of these camels, it fled, it ran away. And so the companions sought after it, and it tired them. And so among the people was somebody who had a horse. And so he took his horse, and he took his spear, and he went to the camel, and he threw his spear at the camel, and he killed it. فَحَبَسَهُ اللَّهُ, and he killed it. فَقَالَ, and so the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he commented, and so this is a new situation, because we know, and we mentioned this in Kitabu al-Hajj, that the way in which a camel is supposed to be slaughtered, and I believe we put a video up on YouTube on our channel, which you can see how a camel is supposed to be slaughtered according to the Sunnah, is that you stab it from the neck, right? And you let the wool, and you let the blood flow out from the camel. Sahih. However, here he didn't do that. Rather, he hit a spear and he stabbed it, or he pierced it. And so the Messenger of Allah, he said, إِنَّ لِهَذِهِ الْبَهَائِمِ أَوَابِدَكَ أَوَابِدِ الْوَحْشِ, that these bahaim, which of course bahima refers to the types of camel, the types of cattle that zakat is due upon, right? The camel, the cow, and the sheep, or the goat, right? And so these bahaim, they have this tendency, these wild tendencies. And so whatever you find a camel and it's overpowered you, then فَصْنَعُ بِهِ هَكَذَا, and do with it what that person did, i.e. you can kill it in that way. And so the asr is that you kill it in a way in which is mentioned by the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and is the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. However, if it shows wild tendencies and you are unable to control it, then kill it in the way in which this person killed it, i.e. by stabbing it with a spear. And so then the companion asked the Messenger ﷺ that we are going to meet our enemy tomorrow, and we don't have with us a knife, وَلَيْسَ مَعْنَا مُدَى, i.e. a knife to slaughter our animals with. أَفَنَذْبَحُ بِالْقَصَبِ, can I slaughter with al-qasab? And al-qasab refers to a type of material that is not actually a knife, but it can be sharpened and it can become a knife. طيب. It can be sharpened and it can become a knife. So it's initially a blunt tool, but then you sharpen it and then it becomes kind of like a knife. And so the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, أنهر الدم, that which when you slaughter it, the blood flows out. وَذُكِرَ اسْمُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ, and the name of Allah was mentioned upon it, then فَكُلُوا مِنْهَا So any sharp object, whether it be made from glass or from plastic, whatever it is that you have sharpened, and it's a sharp tool that can cut deeply into the throat of the knife, and it can cause the blood to gush out, then, and you mention the name of Allah upon it, of course, the istihbab in the Shafi'iyya, فَكُلُوهُ, then eat from it. And then the Messenger of Allah made an exception, لَيْسَ السِّنَّ وَالظُّفْرِ. And you can't use, so the exception to this principle, so the asr that any sharp object will do, except for tusks, السِّن وَالظُّفْرِ, and nails. And so the nail of an animal, like a tiger or something, those animals that have long nails, or those animals that have long tusks, like the elephant tusks and so on, you can't use those two types of objects that are sharp to slaughter an animal with. And the reason why is أَمَّ السِّنُّ فَعَظْمٌ. As for the sin, it's a bone, and you can't use the bone, because if you were to use the bone, the blood that comes out from the animal will force the bone to become najis, and so then you'll be using a najis material to perform the slaughtering of an animal. And as we know, لا يجوز الاستنجاء بالعظم. A person cannot purify himself with a bone, because the act of purifying himself with the bone will force that bone to become impure itself. وَأَمَّا الظُّفْرُ, as for the nails, then it's something that was used by the people of Habasha. And as we know, the people of Habasha, قَوْمٌ كُفَّارٌ. And so this is an evidence, an application of the hadith of the Messenger, the famous hadith of the Prophet, مَنْ تَشَبَّهْ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. That you're not allowed to liken yourself to a people. And so the dhufr was something that belonged to the people of Habashan that they used to use. And it was something that that made them recognizable. So فَكَانَ شَعِيرَةً لَهُمْ. It was like a flag for them. طيب. And so because it was like some sort of shi'ar for these individuals, and they were قَوْمٌ كُفَّار, disbelievers, the Messenger of Allah forbade us from likening ourselves to them. And so we can't use a dhufr, nails, whether it be from an animal, generally speaking, tigers and those animals that have long nails, sharp nails, you can't use that or sharp claws, مثلا, you can't use that to slaughter an animal with. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. We'll stop it بإذن الله. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت. أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.